Thank you very much for coming to Elche to give us this interesting lecture. So please, this is your state.
Thank you, Javier.
We are happy to hear to you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Marijana Curcic. I'm, like Javier said, from University of Belgrade, from the Faculty of Pharmacy, and belong to the Department of Toxicology. So that is the mutual interest of us and how we met actually in our lives. And we know each other, you will see later, for 13 years already. We choose today this topic because the question of perception in risk is very interesting. Actually, it is a question how to convert science to the language of general population, to the language of journalists, to the language of students, how to make science understandable to anybody who is not from the world of science. I will show you also some examples later on this. What are challenges of risk communication? First of all, risk communication is very important. It is stepped after risk assessment. Risk assessment introduces hazard assessment, then dose-response relationship, then exposure assessment and risk assessment. And after we assess the risk and, for example, discover that risk is not acceptable, then time is coming to communicate with people, with journalists, with general population, with regulatory bodies in all countries, all around the world, about risk and how to communicate on risk if we are using toxicological or scientific manner, and you know much more than people, and how to convert your language to the language which is understandable from general population or from other population who wants to hear this information. Why risk communication actually is very important? Because it needs to be effective. To attach the population, not too much, to make them be afraid of risk from some dangerous chemicals like POPs are, but to make them aware enough to know how to handle these chemicals, to follow the signs what are given. Then it needs, sometimes when accidents happen, it needs to be fast. There for POPs chemicals, you know, for Seveso accident or something like that happened in Italy. It was in 1976. But anyway, as fast as possible, make communication with people around, with journalists. If some not so nice news go to one newspaper, it can be disaster for the country. Everybody could be in panic, and panic is not a good thing for risk communication and for risk mitigation measures. So we will not handle the risk as a responsible toxicologist. It have to be understandable, easy to be understandable for different target groups. So it is very important to identify who the target group is. Children, sometimes students. When I'm talking to my students in Serbia about toxicology, I'm talking totally different than when I'm talking to journalists. When I'm talking to journalists, it's totally different than I'm talking to children, but almost the same. Yes, practice showed me that with journalists, I have to start from the elementary levels. I'm not thinking nothing wrong about them. I think very good things, but they are the ones who are widespreading this information, disseminate this information on risk around us from chemicals. And risk actually is not hazard. Risk is probability. And risk depends not only from the hazard. Risk depends from exposure as well. So if we can handle somehow exposure, probably we can handle the risk as well. This is important thing to know. So when you explain to children, don't put this toy in your mouth. it is not accident like Cerveza, but it is accident in the home conditions. Don't put this toy in your mouth, because you can, you cannot say to 2 years old children, it contains dangerous chemicals. Child will not understand this message. Maybe one day it will stay somewhere in the brain, and one day it will appear, but maybe 20 years later. But when it is 2 years old, it will, there is no sense. But for my students' population, when I talk to them about toxicology, we start from the labeling of chemicals. And we are looking labels on the methanol, acetonitrile, chloroform, some other organic solvents or some other chemicals we have in the lab, and we handle with them. And we start from the label, and actually we read the message on the label. On the label is the message from all toxicological studies made before these chemicals is placed on the market. All toxicological studies about acute toxicity, oral, dermal, inhalation, irritation of skin, eye damage, skin sensitization, aspiration, specific target organ toxicity after single or after repeated exposure, everything is actually on the label of chemicals, written like pictogram, like word, like H sign, when we are talking about toxicological properties. And it is written by text, dangerous, please use gloves. That means it causes irritations of skin. And it is written. Usually in Serbia, I can say that people don't follow instructions, what they can read on the cleaning products, for example, for the bathroom or something like that. Do you read carefully? I can admit for myself, I started after I introduced myself to toxicology and to labeling, then I started to pay attention to this. But general population is still, particularly in developing countries like Serbia, is they are not aware enough to read the label. And this label is actually communication with general population. Communication with somebody who is working with who is working with chemicals occupationally goes over the safety data sheet, so they can read lot of information how to behave in the you know, for safety data sheet, am I right? Yes, that each chemical is followed by safety data sheet, and it is written how to handle the chemical, how to store the chemicals, are there any incompatibilities, don't put together metal, sodium with chlorinated organic solvents, for example, because you can cause the fire or something like that, avoid the static electricity. There are instructions like this, and what protective equipment to use. So risk communication is actually everywhere on every product we are using in everyday life, particularly chemicals, but you can see in home, in kitchen, in your bathroom, signs of communication in risk, because they want you to avoid exposure to chemicals. And if you control exposure, you can control the risk. And risk actually is probability some adverse effect to be happened to the humans as well. So there is also something that is, compliance. Compliance is actually response of the public. There is not only public, response of different target groups. And it is very important to check compliance, to have indicators for compliance. Do they really follow instructions they got through the messages or not? Or if they hear information from scientists on the TV, do they understand or not? If they read the newspapers this morning, do they understand or not? So this compliance is very important part. Then there is another aspect. If you want to discuss about dangerous chemicals and all decisions all around Europe is in all regulatory body, like European Food Safety Authority, EFSA, like ECHA, European Chemical Agency, like EMEA, European Medical and Drug Agency, they made decision after long discussions, after collecting information from different sources, but relevant sources of information, relevant web pages, not from Wikipedia, not from Google, not from internet pages like this. That's important to know what information, if you are students of toxicology or PhD students from any other discipline, doesn't matter, to use relevant source of information. If it is relevant one, it belongs to some authority who is taking care of this. And all conclusions on chemicals are made actually after long discussions on this topic. Professor, I'm watching Professor Villanova, he probably knows, he probably was involved in different working groups. Javier also was involved in different working groups around Europe, and they discussed a lot about different things, and they know that procedure is 1 year, 2 years, sometimes 3 years long, and scientists are discussing, and what is important to respect opinion of other people. Everybody has right to think something with good arguments, then arguments are coming to the table. It is nothing personally. It is just talking about some issue related with risk assessment of chemicals, and it is about respect others' opinion, listen other people carefully, watch them carefully. You have a lot of things to hear, then collect what you need, and maybe change perspective, maybe change opinion, maybe discover a new field of interest for you. But this respect is very important. This respect is very important in everyday life. I believe you like very much in when you go to have coffee here in Elche University, I believe you like when somebody is laughing to you and serving coffee. It is a way of communication as well, but it is much more comfortable when you see the smile on the face than if it is not there. It is much comfortable when you see that person is not nervous, if communication goes smooth, easy. It's much better than when people are making faces like this and don't want to communicate and don't want to exchange information. So it is everything question of risk communication. But in scientific community, there is no problem. I mean, after long experience, you learn how to discuss with arguments, and everything is usually fine. And have in mind different perspectives. I can bet Spain looked totally different from the plane where I landed Alicante, but in Alicante, sea is totally different. And Goncha's house is very top, and view from her house is totally different. So I see until today three perspectives of Alicante and Elche. I see perspective from the plane, from her house, and from walking on the seaside with all colleagues of us. Same is in the life and in the risk communication. Different perspectives are important to have in mind, that people have different perspectives. Maybe from this side, I cannot see what is behind me. It is up to my perspective. If I change it like this, then I know what is going on in this corner, but I don't know what is going on here. So for me, if I'm giving lecture now here, seminar, I suppose it is much better to stay like this than to speak into the corner and turn my back to you. It is out of communication.
It's a very simple case to make it basic, but important for very important issues in toxicology.
Toxicology letters in 2004 published very nice publication on public and effective risk communication. I can suggest you to read it. I suppose this presentation will be visible, so you can follow the title and find a very nice text on risk communication from, sorry, I did not mention authors of this communication, but they explain very nice how to make public and effective risk communication. And I'm very thankful to this article. It helped me a lot when I was preparing, reading articles to prepare this presentation for you. Where actually risk communication is in totally risk assessment. I mentioned already these phases, risk characterization, when we characterize the risk and realize that risk is unacceptable, then it is time to manage the risk. How? To use protective equipment, to use gloves in home, to use maybe eyeglasses in the labs. Do you use white coats when you have exercises in the lab? I suppose yes. Okay. Somebody who is cooking, they are using just to cover the suit from the oil from making pancakes or something like that.
But people who are occupationally exposed to the chemicals,
they have to use. They must use. It is obligatory. Personal protective equipment, PPE, usually written, and also levels of different chemicals here in our environment must be measured because of tracking concentrations, and are we going to be exposed to the higher level than it is allowed. Maximal allowable concentrations are defined in different rule books. In Serbia we have old one from 1991, so it is 46 years old, but I hope we will have newer one, we will accept from EU values, but I suppose you have a new one because I'm following what is going on here, not here in Spain directly, but generally, and what values we can expect to be allowed in our environment. Doesn't matter, are we at home? And it's time to take some risk management measures. If you put pesticides on the apples in Hamburg, for example, the diazinon is one, difflubenzuron is one of the plant protection products, very dangerous for the water, aquatic ecosystem. So there is need have at least 20 meters long mitigation zone. I mean, zone separated from the field should stop, then to have
a soil zone until the water to the sea or river Elba in order to protect the ecosystem from influence of this plant protection products, which is used for nice Hamburg apples. So we can use this,
but just water ecosystem must be at least 20 meters far from the use of this pesticide, let's say. So this is risk mitigation and risk management. In risk communication is actually here
in risk management system. This is the part of prevention. The best way
actually is prevention, to make preventive measures. We were talking yesterday about costs of illnesses or cost of days when people are not able to go to the job. And what is the price of life if somebody died because of carcinoma, maybe caused by some chemicals exposure. And there are a lot of calculation. It is socioeconomic analysis. It shows that every 1 euro can give you back 2, 3, or 4 euros back after 5 years when you make prevention measures. But when risk happened or it is unacceptable, risk mitigation measures should be taken as well, and risk communication is coming here. The main goals of risk communications are to share information
vital for saving life, if it is accident and or vehicle dose symptoms, to protect health, and minimizing harm to self and others, to change beliefs. That's interesting. And to change behavior. To change behavior, it takes time. I realized from different actions taken in Serbia that if we want to separate the waste,
it really took time to teach people how to separate waste and why it is important. If you mention recycling, it does not mean almost anything to somebody who is not educated, who is living in a rural area. So what, recycling? And if you mention reduce, reuse, number, don't use heating system, each house use centralized heating system, again they say why. If your answer is because of dioxins or sulfur dioxide, again they will say, so what? Because for, I'm not thinking something wrong, but they are just interested in to growing up, to be farmers, to take care of the land, to grow up wheats and corns and everything we need to eat. But they are not interested in dioxins and sulfur dioxide. We are the ones who are responsible for that, to take care over this. We decided to be toxicologists. So responsibility belongs to us and population who is educated to speak about toxicology. And main tasks of risk communication actually are listed here. What I want to emphasize is monitoring and assessing outcomes, what is important. Risk communication by itself is important, but this monitoring, does risk communication work? And outcome, is it really helpful in this situation or not? It is really important to give feedback, to have feedback and know, are you on the right way to have when you make risk communication, or you need to change something in your behavior, perspective, or something else. Like traditional risk factors for diabetes, I choose just like to explain before, we thought traditionally it is because of obesity, it is because of genetic predisposition, lack of exercise, old age, and it is still the truth. But new evidences are coming that some chemicals can contribute to obesity as well, and POPs, persistent or organic pollutants, are one of them. Bisphenol A is one of them, but it is not topic for today. Let's stay to the POPs chemicals. How about POPs chemicals? Have you ever met POPs chemicals in your life? What do you think? If you watch around you here in this room, may you suppose where you can find chemicals in the doors, in the walls, in the chairs, maybe in the laptop? What do you think? Okay, I will say a few words later. Persistent organic pollutants are listed on Stockholm Convention. Why Stockholm is the problem? Problem is even emission happened in Ecuador or in Mediterranean zone. Emission goes to the air, then go to the north, then when meet colder weather, by rain it falls down, then again evaporate when weather is changing, and again go to the north and to the north. So Sweden, even they take care, really take care about the environment, they got a lot of POP chemicals in their environment. But POP chemicals actually are coming from the southern countries. And chemicals do not recognize borders. That's the problem. They don't need passport. They travel like they want. So the root of one chemicals, and this is the effect of grasshopper. Maybe you heard sometimes about that, that one chemical is jumping in the air, then jump down, then again in the air and down. And for example, polar white bear, some scientists measure the level of different type of persistent organic pollutants in the fat tissue of polar bear, and polar bear does not have factories. Polar bear does not produce telephones or laptops, or does not produce cars or airplanes. And the level of pop chemicals in the fat tissue of polar bears is very high. That means it comes somehow to him. He's just living to the Arctic, and he's catching the fish, eating normal food, and he does not work everyday job like we do. He is living his Arctic life. I mean, he's enjoying there. He likes this Arctic to be cold as much as possible because he needs this food from the water to go out, and he can eat then. So polar bear is not happy with pop chemicals. Even he did not produce any of them, and he does not need. He does not use mobile phones to call somebody. But it is everything up to production in the this zone of the world. To be persistent organic pollutants, so Stockholm or Sweden decided to make Stockholm Convention in 2004. Actually, in 2001. They decided, and in 2004 it was accepted in May, and they chose the particularly hazardous chemicals to humans and to the environments. And persistent POPs is from, P is from persistent, O is from organic, P second one is from pollutants, and they need to meet some PBT criteria. Maybe you heard sometimes about PBT criteria. P means persistent. Persistent is long half-life in, for example, in soil longer than 6 months, in sediment longer than 6 months, in water longer than 60 days, if I'm right. Don't trust me full. Bioaccumulative means that bioconcentration factor is very high. For example, if one tuna fish is living in the sea, a bioconcentration factor should be higher than 5,000. That means that concentration in water of 1 milligram per liter will result in concentration of POPs chemicals in tuna fish 5,000 milligrams per kilogram. Imagine that bioconcentration from water collected from one tuna. So this bioconcentration factor actually is telling us about potential for this bioaccumulative behavior. And T has two meanings. One meaning is toxic. Second one is transport to long distance. But I already mentioned grasshopper and polar bear, who is suffering from our emission of dangerous chemicals. This is science. These are evidences. Let us convert ease to perception of risk among general population. What happened? I just gave you the web page of Stockholm Convention, and I want to say in 2004, 12 dozen were accepted on the list of Stockholm Convention. Then 9 were added in 2009, 9 extra, and now more than 25 chemicals are on the list. They can be POPs pesticides, they can be industrial chemicals. People produced industrial chemicals, for example, brominated defenylators. I like them very much because they are used for furniture, for cars, for laptops or mobile phone. Because when you talk about mobile phone, maybe you can feel it is warming. Also, laptop is warming. And in this material, plastic, flame retardants are inside in order to avoid fire. So these flame retardants were added until 2004. And all products around us, if they are made before 2004, they probably contain POPs chemicals. cars, buses, trains in the seat. This pure foam in the seats also contains pop chemicals. Hotels were full of pop chemicals because they want to avoid fire in the hotel. So if you catch with the cigarette, just you will make just one point on the wall. But if there is no in the wall, if in the carpet, if there is no flame retardant, fire will appear. It stops fire for 10 minutes, something like that. And they are mixed with all plastic, and they are mixed with this material. They are not content of material, they are mixed with material, and they can be released from material during the use, because we are walk over the carpet every day. We handle our computers every day, so they could be released. What is the problem now? Now the problem is mostly electronical for flame retardants, brominated ones, electronical and electrical waste. If landfills are not controlled, there is possibility they to be released into environment, and through the environment very easy to go to the fish. We can eat fish and they can enter our body. Beside industrial chemicals, pesticides, there are non-intentionally products like dioxins, usually by burning the waste. In poor countries, people usually burning the waste. They don't know it is dangerous. The point is to diminish amount of waste, but they don't know actually how dangerous it is. This smoke made of this fire is very interesting, but also Stockholm Convention divide pop chemicals in three groups under the Annex A. These chemicals must be eliminated totally in the products with deadlines. In Annex B, there are restrictions. For example, DDT is one who is belonging to, this is Annex B restriction. DDT is the one. Why? In Vietnam, for example, mosquitoes that are vectors for malaria, damage to human health and number of deaths is so high. So for them, they calculated risk-benefit analysis, and they calculated that use of DDT in closed indoor, it is much better than to leave mosquitoes to bite the people and to be sick from malaria. WHO, World Health Organization, also dealt with pop chemicals, where actually pop chemicals are around us. Here is an example of producing pop chemicals, how they enter soil. From soil, they go into water environment, for example. Then small fish eat smaller fish, big fish eat smaller, and in the top of the trophic level, the level of pop chemicals is very high. From the sky, level of pop chemicals was marked with these fluorescent colors and how they move. From my experience and group of from my faculty and department of toxicology where I work, how I try to communicate with people regarding results we obtained in the study. In this study, we did interactions between cadmium and decabrominated defenylator on blood cells count in rats. And what was the question? Question was, here is multiple factorial regression analysis, very nice statistical tool for scientists, and we are very happy to hear somebody knows to do that, and happy to see in other collaborators how they do and to see how it works. Then we use response surface modeling to make the plot. Then we move this to make isobologram and to interpret interactions by using isobologram curves. And what is the message to general population? When I was talking to the students, question was my blood, because only blood cell count is something that they can recognize. They ask, my blood, what is the threat? Should I avoid? Where is the cadmium? Where is the brominated defenylator? What should we do? So questions that you can get from as a feedback are very simple. So my multiple factorial regression analysis does not mean anything to them. Even I made very nice isobolgram, I'm very proud of this, but for general population it does not work. So make it simple. Second question was, when we measure level of dioxin, non-dioxin-like PCBs in 10 fish species in Danube River, because we had NATO bombing in 1999, and after NATO bombing we measured the levels in 2001 and in 2006, so 5 years period, and upstream from the place of bombing and downstream, but far enough species not to be mixed. So distance was proper. In the title, it is written non-dioxin-like PCBs, and students, I was talking with my students about this, PhD students, and they asked me, why you measure non-dioxin-like PCBs if you explain us and literature says that dioxin-like PCBs are acting by aryl hydrocarbon receptor and can cause different damage. Why did you measure this, non-dioxin-like PCBs? Question is totally correct. But they have knowledge in toxicology, and a PhD student, postgraduate students, they can understand. And the answer is actually that agency for controlling the environment established criteria that if you measure these six non-dioxin-like indicator PCBs congeners, they represent half of total amount of PCBs. So I just add an extra article to the students and ask them, please read carefully. You have 2 days, and you will find the answer in this. This principal compound analysis and something like that. We were discussing how to transfer this knowledge to the population, because main question is fish safe to be eaten? Is it safe or not? That is all what public wants to know. Is it safe or not? We had also situation with the politicians when they ask, is it safe or not? it happened once. One decided in front of media to drink a glass of milk because we had affair with aflatoxin M in milk level in cow, and politicians use wrong way to prove that something is not harmful to the human health. He just took the glass of milk and said, okay, can you see nothing happened to me? That means milk is correct. Actually, level of aflatoxin in milk was very, very above the allowed level, and all this milk need to be taken out from the market and not necessarily destroyed. It could be diluted by milk with not so high amount of aflatoxin. So we had this affair like this. And sometimes in this communication, it's not good to sit in the front of people and say, I drink one glass of milk and everything is fine. What also happened, we mentioned, we had study on internal dose, hepatotoxicity and target tissue dose. Target tissue dose means we measure the, but when I communicate with the students, again, I made mistake in my communication. I'm now talking from my own mistakes I made in the life and how it happened. I explained that target tissue dose, and that is very interesting when you measure level of brominated, decarbominated defenylator in liver, then you avoid toxicokinetics and only toxicodynamics stay. Only stay what will happen in the liver. You avoid absorption, intake, absorption, distribution in the body and everything. I have level in the target tissue. And I did not mention rats at all. So they thought that actually everything happened to humans. And they asked, who is going to take my liver and when? They were worried about that. That was because my wrong communication on risk and my wrong explanation about what is going on. 7-8 years ago, we tried to communicate with children. I was happy to this tank control was the leader of this project. We were involved together and we tried to communicate with teenagers, and we were wondering, that is also a nice experience, and we learned a lot. Faculty of Education was involved in this project. You should see the first version and the last version of this movie. This movie is available if you put Goncha Chakmak YouTube channel. You will see this movie. You can see this movie in Spanish. It is made in English, in Spanish, in Turkish language, in Catalonian, and in Croatian language. So it is available in different languages and accepted as a good English version is accepted for EU. But it is very nice. You can type and watch the movie. You should see the first version and the last one. In the first version, we were so scientific. Toxic effects, carcinomas. We use high-grade communication. And people from Faculty of Education told us, put yourself in the skin, in the shoes of 12-year-old child. Actually, we brought son of colleague of us. He was 12 years old and we say something to him. And if he is watching us like this, we know that we are not on the right way to communicate with the children. So we corrected our vocabulary. We corrected our way to present the data totally from the beginning to the end. When you learn from this, and also movie from movie academy, they were involved in the project. They teach us also how with visual effect and with audio effects you can affect the population, target population, and want to communicate the risk. So this is raising awareness of healthy food and healthy eating among children. Nice experience, and that was one of the picture we had. Like POPs chemicals could be POPs pesticides, for example, lindan. Lindan was used when I was working in the pharmacy as a pharmacist, because basically I'm a pharmacist. In 1999, I was selling lindan in pharmacy against these bags in the hair, you know. But in 2007, lindan became the member of the list of POPs chemicals. So there is short way from one medical to go from the pharmacy to banned chemicals. I believe lindan was very well checked to be used as drug. I mean, to treat these small bugs in the... I don't know the name. Okay. So, for example, some of pesticides, POPs pesticides, were used for spraying trees, for spraying salad, for spraying. And this cow is near the salad, and this cow is eating and bioaccumulating milk, because milk is very fat. There is a lot of fat in milk, about 10%. And chicken are eating something here. And in the next step on your table, actually, you can see apples, you can see fish, you can see cheese from cow, you can see milk from cow, and everywhere are these red dots. Red dots are actually POP chemicals, potentially emitted maybe in the past, but I mentioned they are persistent, so they stay very long in the environment and they can enter our food chain. So we can enter them into our body. And they will live in our body if they are liposoluble, and they can stay very long in our body. Okay, I don't know why I emphasize these two chicken. Our outcome of this movie, we tried to make evaluation of risk communication. Is it effective or not? And the results were very nice. We are proud on this because after the pre-test with 12 years old children done in Turkey, in Spain, in Croatia, how many children totally were involved in the study? I don't know how many hundred thousand children were involved in this study. We checked the level of knowledge before they watched the movie and after the watching the movie. And some time after the watching the movie, and the level of awareness really increased. So impact could be made using tools like TV, like video, like movie. These are POPs chemicals all around us. And at how many places can you identify POPs? Do you still think there are POPs around us here in this room? Possibly. Do you see at least one object here that POPs chemicals is inside?
You.
Me? Yes, it is possible. Absolutely. I was thinking on me. and let's go to the question of perception. how people understand each other and how percept information they get on risk in risk communication. When I say mouse, what do you think, mouse or mouse? Which one do you like more? It depends, actually. When somebody mentioned mouse, if I were working on computer, probably I would think about this one. If I am coming from vivarium and I just finished experiment with animals, probably I will think on this one because I'm taking care of them. Did they eat enough or drink water enough? In everyday life, I don't know which one is the first. I can check in the future. You can check as well. Just ask, what mouse? First one, second one, or both at the same time. So that's the main reason for a difference between message you are sending and perception from people who should listen your message. So risk perception, according to the literature, is own opinion of the likelihood of risk associated with performing a certain activity or choosing a certain lifestyle. It means use of chemicals and pop chemicals around us. And according to the dictionary, perception is a noun. And perception is ability to see, to hear, or become aware or of something through the senses. So all these eyes, ears, feelings, senses could be used to reach appropriate perception in the general population or target group where you send message. That's important. Eyes, ears, senses, taste in our mouth, smell, something is associated. We are not the same. Different people react different. And in neurophysiological processes, it is the way which something is regarded, understood, or interpreted. Sometimes when I trying to send a message, when I ask somebody to give me feedback, I can understand that my message totally was wrong. Like in the student case, is fish safe to eat or not? Who will take my liver? Nobody will take your liver, just I did not mention rats. So that's the question, how you send the message, and perception is how somebody or me, how I am accepting the message. Maybe my way is not okay, maybe I am not good to transfer this information. Have you ever played, do you have this game when somebody say the word to somebody else, not word, sentence, and somebody else to somebody else, and when you ask fifth in the queue, he said or she, totally, something totally different than it is. That's a question of perception, actually. That is how perception could be changed if message is not sent appropriately. So use senses. Use eyes of people. So make a message visible to people who can see the message. Make a message listenable. Easy to be heard. When there is something wrong, strong. Because I'm strong, I will do nothing wrong. Something like that. This rhyme at the end of the sentences works. Usually in the titles of some messages you sent. A lot of messages, a very good example of messages are messages that you can see in the advertisement during the TV show. They are masters of sending messages. Masters of sending messages. They go directly to the feelings, to the ears, or to the eyes of people and somehow excite them and make us to want to buy a mobile phone. Sometimes I'm buying something, actually I don't know why, honestly. Just because I saw on advertisements, so that means they influenced me. It is not good, but it is good for risk communication. I can influence my target population if you want and you're careful and you take care on words you use. For example, what we learned a lot, don't use negative association. When I'm with students in the lab, I'm not using words, don't do that. If I say don't, that means they will not, unconscious part of our brain does not recognize don't, not this word. Just recognize the rest of this. So I'm not using don't, because we have fire in the, because of ether in the air. And one student, she was keeping the mobile phone in the hand. And she could not leave the mobile phone because she's addicted a little bit addicted. Even fire is in front of her. I was very worried about her face and hair and everything, and worried about whole lab because ether was in front of her. But she could not move the and everybody screamed, don't use mobile phone, don't use mobile phone, don't use, and she did not. I said, remove this mobile phone from your hand, and she did it. This no messages does not work, but direct messages that exclude no, they work usually in life. Try. Like with children, don't run, you will fall, they usually fall down. If you say, please stop, they will stop. This positive attitude in sending messages is very nice in the life, and it is very nice in communication and in perception. When you this attitude use, opposite side will not accept this no, and will not be treated like there is some danger around us and our conversation. Feeling will be much, much better than in not so direct. So about senses, how do you feel about pop chemicals today? Do you feel happy, afraid, sad, frustrated? Do you feel surprised? Confused? Do you feel hopeful, worried? Do you feel hopeless? So all these feelings and much more feelings than this are feelings that are affected by risk communication. And feelings are a result of our perception in risk communication. I mentioned TV and advertisement as a very powerful weapon for our feelings and our behavior. Particularly in shopping, but also with chemicals. These different behaviors could be used to make people not to be frustrated. Frustration is so dangerous, but make them not depressed because of pop chemicals, not worried, but little bit worried. Aware is the, let's say, word, proper word. Let them be aware that pop chemicals are around us, and if we handle the exposure, we can handle the risk from pop chemicals. And perceptional risk in this nice publication is given this information. So everything is up to the question how to understand and how to interpret. Use perception for prevention of exposure to POPs, to manage products and waste containing POPs, to teach children and general population on POPs hazards, to teach journalists on POP hazards. And I believe you got some ideas in the meantime how to communicate with somebody else, not necessarily with, about POPs chemicals, but also about some other dangerous chemicals, and that you will check, did you reach your objective or goal? Or this person, maybe sometimes somebody just don't understand you, even does not show, even you're sure you said everything, somebody just don't understand. People need to see, to hear, to feel. So just have in mind that sometimes everything is up to misunderstanding each other. In everyday life it is very important, in marriage particularly. So how to communicate science? Is it easy? No, it is not easy at all. One of interesting suggestion is if 5 years old child can understand the message, then message is clear. We used 12 years old child, and we were very unhappy until we succeeded to explain something to 12 years old child. Imagine 5 years old child and your explanation, risk of pop from POPs chemicals. If you want, you can. If you don't want, it is not obligatory, absolutely. Just think how, if you have relatives or neighbors or something, how you will communicate about risk from some chemicals with a child who is 5 years old. And you don't touch this. It is not proper way. What will you say? How you behave? What will be the expression of your face or your body language? There is proof of coffee, simplify, be brief. It is very important to be brief. One sentence, two sentences, not more than this. Avoid scientific jargon. I told you because I did not mention rats, so they were afraid somebody will take their liver. Educate people. Education is very important as well. And I want to say thank you to colleagues who invited me to be here. I mentioned we met 13 years ago. It was risk assessment summer school in Germany. And luckily, we are still together. We succeed to see each other every year. And last year, we were very proud to give interview to the IUTOXIS International World Union of Toxicology, to give interview to them because they were financing us, supporting us. They gave us half fellowship for this our when we met each other. And they're very proud that they have four people who are still working together from four different countries. So they make interview about us, how we met, what are we doing, and our adventures. Here we are in 2006. Here is, that's me, Javier, that's you. And here is Gonča, and here is our friend Ksenija from Croatia. That's we are in the Zagreb, city of Zagreb, maybe three years ago. We cannot remember because we meet every year. It is very nice to change the country. That is the last year in Belgrade. Was held the Congress of Toxicology for the CTDC for developing countries. So three of us succeed to be together with one of our, Elaine Faustman, she is our supervisor from IUTOX. And thank you very much. I hope I succeed to excite your eyes, your ears, your feelings. I hope you feel good after this, and I hope you will think in the future about all messages you send to the people. How nice can be if we communicate nice, not with screaming, and to cause nice feeling in other people. Thank you so much for this.